This tutorial will explain some theory behind soil deformation and we'll also look at some practical example. We'll start with this slide where we have some theoretical considerations, and we'll look at some soil sample which is shown here. It's a cylindrical sample and we know the length of the sample and we know the radius. What is going to happen to the sample if we apply some load stress? Sample will deform. So there are two types of deformation that can occur: drain deformation, when water can be drained out of the soil during load, and undrained deformation, when we have water in the sample but for some reason water cannot easily drain out of it. So if we have a drain deformation, so this is the sample before we apply load, and this is the sample after we apply load, you will see that the size of the sample will decrease. It's a natural thing because we will try to make it denser and we will squeeze water out of it. So to estimate the deformation, principal deformation in the vertical and horizontal direction, we're going to use these two equations. In these two equations, we need to know changes in the principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 3, as well as we need to know the Youngest modulus and Poisson's ratio. This Youngest modulus and Poisson's ratio, we assume they're for drain conditions, and this is what it means, dash, which means a drain condition. This formula to calculate radial deformation, so change in this direction, as you're shown here. So that was the initial radius, and this is the radius after soil was deformed. Again, for the drain deformation, we're going to use drain values of Youngest modulus and drain values of Poisson's ratio. So for Poisson's ratio, it will range from 0.2 to 0.3. Poisson's ratio. So now let's look at the undrained deformation. Because water cannot drain out of the sample, so it will still stay in the sample. So after we apply load, there will be some changes in the height or also radius, diameter of the sample, but there won't be any change in the volume. So volume of the sample before and after will be the same. So in this case, for the drain deformation, typically we have volume before, it's larger than volume after. So again, to estimate changes in the vertical direction, where we have major principal stress and minor principal stress in the lateral direction, we use similar formulas. And here you just need to pay attention that for undrained conditions, we use undrained Youngest modulus and we use undrained Poisson's ratio that we always assume equal to 0.5. So we know this one. If it's not given to us, we just say it's 0.5. So now let's look at this example where we have sample which is placed in a triaxial machine, which means that the soil sample is under confining pressure. So we have sigma 3, which is applied on the sample in all directions here. And after that, we apply load. We apply load, which is equal to sigma 1. And the initial height of the sample is 75 millimeters, and the diameter is 37.5 millimeters. So when we applied load, we measured that the change in the height, so I suppose here, it will be 3 millimeters. So, and the reduction in the volume, because the test is drain, so this is the keyword drain. There will be a reduction in the volume, which is equal to this value. So basically what we do, we just measure how much water comes out of the sample, and that will give us change in the volume. So what we need to do based on these initial parameters, we need to estimate the axial strain, volumetric strain, radial strain, and shear strain of the specimen. And this is what we're going to do in the next slide. So we will start with the change in the volume. So we know that the change in the volume is this much. So what we need to find is what was the initial volume. And we know that the sample is cylindrical. So volume is pi times diameter of the sample in the power of 2 divided by 4 and times h. So we can rewrite this as 3.14, which is pi divided by 4 times the radius, its diameter is 37.5, and we're going to change it to meters, so we divide by 1000, and this is going to be in the power of 2, and we also multiply it by the height of the sample. It's 75 millimeters. We're going to change it to meters, so we divide by 1000 as well, and that will give us about 82.85 times 10 in the power of negative 6 cubic meters. Okay, so with the milliliters, we're going to change milliliters to cubic meters, so it will be equal to the value of 1.645 times 10 in the power of negative 6 cubic meters. So then volumetric strain, based on the definition of this volumetric strain, is change in the volume to the original volume of the sample. So we have 1.645 times 10 power negative 6 divided by 82.85 power 10 negative 6, well, approximately 0.02. So now we're going to find the axial strain. So axial strain, it's epsilon 1, it's equal, again, based on the definition, it's change in the height to the total height. So change in the height will be L minus L1, or in this case we have L0 minus L divided by L. So we don't need to change it to meters because it's a ratio, so we use millimeters. So change in the height was 3, and the initial height was 75. Will give us approximately 0.04. Now we're going to find change in the radial direction. So in this case, we are going to rearrange this formula, and that will give us a change in epsilon 3. It's equal 1 over 2. Change in the volumetric strain minus change in the axial strain. So that should give us approximately negative 0.01. So the sample shrinks in this case. And the final one, which is change in the shear strain, so we're going to use this formula. So that's pretty simple. So change in the shear strain will be 2 over 3, and then we have changes in axial and radial direction, so that will give us approximately 0.033.